Hey, how are you today? That was a little weak, you know? I like the great, okay? All right. How are you today?
Wonderful.
Okay, and it's okay to say crappy. You could, I mean, if that's the way you are, you could have said that, all right? But say it with conviction, all right? But welcome. It's great to have you at New Hope today. It's our honor and our privilege to have you here. If this is your first time as a guest at New Hope, there are some guest cards or connect cards in the pew, and love for you to fill them out. Drop them in the offering when it comes by. We promise not to irritate you next week, but we'll send you some information through the mail. We hope will be very, very helpful. Those cards are available to everybody in case there's prayer requests or messages to our staff that you'd like to get out to us. Please fill those out and put them in the offering when they come by in just a little bit. A reminder, you have only a couple of more weeks. If you are one of our church family that made a pledge, the 1040i Ivory Coast Africa Building Project. Remember, last year we built a two-room dormitory for junior high kids in a village out in the bush. They have two beautiful Christian teachers who's changing their future and their culture out there. And she asked if we could do another two-room dormitory for the older elementary age kids. These kids are having to walk sometimes 5 and 6 miles a day as elementary kids to get an education. And that is the key. Christ and education is the key to making a difference out in the bush. And so we accepted the challenge. We raised $17,000 at our special Sunday night event for 1040i. If you made that pledge the last Sunday of August, those are due by the end of the month. We pledged $17,000. I think around $12,000 has come in. So the rest of you. And if you weren't there that night and you want to join, just go ahead. Make a check to New Hope. On the envelope, write 1040i, okay, or dormitory, and it will all go to that. But we need to mail it to them by the end of the month so that they can have everything prepared for us in February. New Hope Marriage Retreat, November 13th, 14th, and 15th over in Pacific Grove. You can find more information in the pavilion. You can see Pastor Nick out there, and they'll be happy to get a brochure in your hand and answer more of your questions. This coming Tuesday is Senior Lunch. And Emma Rowland is going to be the guest speaker. And Emma Rowland is going to talk about their quilting class, all right? And Gene shared this in the last service. He was visiting a friend who attends another church in the hospital, and she was so excited they gave her a quilt. And when she opened up the quilt, it said, "Made by Women from New Hope Church." And so that was really very cool. So you're going to hear more about Emma Rowland. Do I have a moment before Gene gets in here? Gene's not sitting next to you, right? Okay. All right. Okay. Next Sunday is Pastor Appreciation Torture Sunday. And there's directions in there of what to do. Okay. In November, and there's a date in your bulletin, this is a day that we are going to say thank you to Gene for his free 15 years of ministry here at New Hope, okay? Don't confuse the two, all right? Pastor Appreciation is normal, what it's been for this past year and what we've done all the other years. In November, okay, and we are taking a special offering. Our board, we've already set aside funds as a gift to give to Gene. We are giving the church family an opportunity. If you would like to add to that gift over the next few weeks, you can put something, the door was opening, you can put something, an envelope right on it, Gene Sperling, thank you gift, all right? And then we'll collect all that, and on that day in November, we're having an open house here, we will then present him with that, okay? So, I have to do that when he's not in here. All right, next Saturday, two big events going on. The Big Shoot is going on up the foothill, Sun Mountain Gun Club. There are informational brochures out on the counter in the pavilion. If you're going to be attending that, please pick up that brochure. There's important information there, or see Gene if you have any questions about it. Speaking, there's Gene right on cue. Looky there. Also on October the 17th is a private church-wide showing of the movie released called Woodlawn. It's opening on that Friday night. We have a theater reserved just for us on Saturday morning. You may pick up the tickets. This is your last chance today. We sold 115 or 16 tickets last week. Tickets are available today out in the pavilion. You can't beat the price. It's cheaper than a matinee. They're $6. This is a great movie for all ages, for men and women. This is not just a chick flick, all right? This is for all of us, so I think you're going to enjoy it. it very, very much. I do have a few prayer requests. Kelly Dillon, still going through rehab. Fran Reed is pretty much homebound now with lung issues. Julia Edwards, we had her service this past Friday here at the church and had a great time with her family and friends. Dorothy Levinson, that we mentioned last Sunday, who had gone under hospice care, she went home to be with the Lord Thursday afternoon. We are awaiting details of when that service is going to be. Brandy Walker, and Brandy happens to be sitting in the sanctuary right now. Brandy, she is the granddaughter and the niece of the Woods, who are part of our 8 o'clock service. I shared Brandy's needs a little over a week ago, that she was going in for a biopsy on a tumor that had intertwined with her optic nerve behind her eye. The results of that biopsy is in. It's the worst possible news that it possibly could be. They made a trip to UCLA on Friday because they have the best treatment for what it is that she's going through. They've laid out the possible plans, and they're doing a few more tests. They go back this coming Wednesday, and will be making some decisions about the treatment. And there's some real challenges there. A strong possibility she'll lose that eye, all right? And depending on if that cancer is moved anywhere else. So would appreciate Brandy and Brian are the parents of 4 children, all right? I remember them when they were all shorter than me. And the other night I found out they're all taller than me, including their daughter. Rather annoying, actually. But if you would be praying for them over these next several weeks, they would appreciate that so much. Barry Pearlstein, and Barry sitting right back there on my left, a regular part of our church family. Barry just found out his new 1-month-old grandbaby has been diagnosed with cystic fibrosis. So a very big challenge for his son and daughter-in-law and for the whole family. So if you would please be remembering to pray for them. Joni Jarbo Anderson, who normally sits on the back row right underneath the air conditioning units, not here for the next couple of weeks. She's back in Washington. If you remember, we were praying for her daughter who was giving birth, all right, in a few weeks. Well, she had the baby. What we were praying for was she has thyroid cancer at the same time that she was pregnant. And so the baby's good, all right? Everything came through well, just fine. But now that she has had an opportunity to recover from giving birth, they now are scheduling the surgery. And that surgery's tomorrow morning up in Washington. So if you would pray for Joni's family, again, they would appreciate it. Janet Matson's niece, Jennifer, is also expecting in the hospital, bedbound. She has lupus, a severe case of lupus at times, and it's flared up right now. And so they're hoping that she can carry the baby another couple of weeks, all right, for best results. And then just heard Fred Hefner, okay, just found out that he is no longer a candidate for a liver transplant, and so he will be coming back to town and going under hospice care. And so if you would remember to pray for Fred. So those are some of the prayer requests that I wanted to share with you. Before we do the offering and see this really great video that Milo found this week, everybody who's sitting on the aisle seat of the center, all right, you will find some little papers, all right there next to you. There's probably 10 or 12 of them. I would love for you to take one and pass them, all right, down your pew, all right? Take one, pass them down your pew, okay? And there's pencils in the pew. You may have a pen in your pocket or your purse. Let me give a little explanation, okay, about this. This ties in with today's sermon. Yes. Stand up. Are you sitting on them? Okay. Somebody steal those? All right. There are extras. Oh, hold on. I came prepared for such a situation as this. Here we go. The guy who put them out missed that row. I put them out. Yeah. Okay. Actually, my wife found this and shared it with me, and I said, "Ooh, boy, you're right, babe. This ties in perfectly with what we want to do today." But before you begin to write an answer in, okay, here's the answer that I'm not looking for. Jesus became real the day I got saved. Okay, no, what I really want to know is, What prompted you to get saved? What was happening at that moment that prompted you to think about Jesus Christ like you've never thought about him before? Okay? This is your answer, okay? And I'm not telling you, I mean, you can write down when I got saved, but what I'm really looking to find out, and you don't have to put your name on this, so I'm not going to know who wrote what, okay? But what I really want to know is, when was it that this life of Christ available to you became real? What were the circumstances that drove you to that? What was the thinking process that brought you to this conclusion? What was going on that made it real? And you have till the offering is finished, okay? And the video, actually you have till the video is over to write your answer here. And this just, remember, one sentence. So this is not an essay. This is finish the sentence. Okay, and we'll connect it for you in a little bit. After the video, those of you who are taking the offering, when the video is over, would you just make a pass back through? And when you guys finish writing them, would you hand them back to the center? Okay, send them back. And do me a favor, don't do this to them. Okay, and certainly don't do this. Okay. Just leave them open, because I'm going to share a few of them, all right, at a certain time in the sermon, and hopefully it will make much more sense then. But, if you want to hand them upside down so you don't think anybody's going to read your answer, okay? All right, are we clear what we're going to do? So you take the time during the offering and the video, write your answer, and then a couple of our ushers will come down the center aisle and pick them up and just hand them off to me when you finish, okay? I'm going to ask our ushers to come forward. Do we have any ushers? Oh, here we go. All right. And would you join with me as we pray? Father, I'm grateful for the beauty of life that you share with us. And the beauty that I'm talking about is not limited to the beauty of Yosemite Park. It's not limited to the beauty of places like Carmel and Monterey. It's not limited to even the harsh beauty of a place like Mojave Desert or Death Valley. But Father, the beauty I'm talking about in life today is the beauty that you share with us when you give to us the life of your Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. And we are not usually ready for that beauty until we come to the conclusion of the ugliness of our own life. When we come to discover that we are extremely judgmental, when we come to the conclusion that we have a lot of selfish tendencies, when we come to the conclusion that my life is not about recognition or popularity, when we come to the conclusions that we're inadequate to handle all of the steps and phases of life and death and eternity, when we come to the conclusion, Father, that we need someone far bigger than ourselves, we come to the conclusion that we are sinners. It's an ugly sounding word, and yet we have to come to that conclusion before we ever come to the end of ourselves and discover that we want and need you. So, Father, we thank you for the ugliness once it's revealed, so that we finally are opened to the beauty that you want to share with us. The beauty of your joy, the beauty of your strength, the beauty of your hope, the beauty of your patience, the beauty of your sufficiency. And so, Father, this morning, we just simply say thank you for the beauty of the life of your Son that you so generously share with us. And, Father, we now thank you for the opportunity that when we discover that beauty, we can't help but want to share what you have blessed us with and give back to your kingdom's work that which you have blessed us with. So thank you for the privilege of giving and sharing today. We trust you for all this in the name of Christ. Amen. This mirror was not up here because Teresa wanted to stare at herself while she played the piano. There's a reason, and we'll get to it in a minute. All right. Thank you for all of your answers. And if there's any blank sheets, if you would just hand them back to the center and put them right by the edge of the pew like they were when you came in, that would be great. Last week we started a three-part series, and it's called The Comparison Trap. And this is the second part. The third part will not be next Sunday. Most of you know, if you were here last week, that this is the series that our small groups are studying together for 3 weeks. Twice a year, we try to all get on the same page, do a study together, so there's kind of this common thing going on with our entire church family. And not everybody goes to small groups, so we thought on Sunday mornings we would preach it as well, so everybody's kind of up to speed. And so last week and this week, you hear the sermon, and then you go to your small group, and you watch a video, and you have your discussions, and hopefully they dovetail together on the same theme. Next week, I'll not be preaching part three, all right, because Appreciation Day. So the third sermon will be preached after you have done your small group study, and then we'll kind of do the wrap-up, all right, on the Sunday following. But today is the Comparison Trap, part two. Let's review just briefly for those of you who might not have been here last week. What was it we looked at? We asked a very important question last week, and that is, have you ever moved into the neighborhood of E-R, all right? I drove all the English teachers crazy last Sunday, all right? Because I used a lot of bad English. It's going to happen again, okay? It's going to happen. Yeah, bad grammar. All right, there we go. They're already picking at me. But I can be pickier than you. All right. And this neighborhood of spelled E-R, is not the land of that's found in the Old Testament. That's where Abraham lived. And you might be asking, how do I know if I live in this land of E-R? And we asked several questions to help you figure that out. And maybe during the week, some of you came to some conclusions. But here were the questions we looked at. Do you feel better when you compare yourself to others? Do you sometimes feel worse when you compare yourself to others? Do you want a bigger than others? In other words, do you want to be richer, skinnier, smarter, taller, prettier, happier, hipper, talented? Let's bring it inside the walls of a church family. Do you want to be spiritually holier, more gifted? Are you bothered by your can of Coke? Do you want more than me? Do I want more than you? Do you ever get excited when somebody who's always had more than you, you're good friends, but you're a little jealous, and they call and tell you, hey, I just got the pink slip at work. And on the phone you say, oh, no. But you're going, yes. That's Do you ever feel superior when others have less than you? Do you consistently live looking to your left and looking to your right to discover where the is? Have you ever gone in debt trying to be more than somebody else? Reminds me, and I shared this last week, of the quote, we buy things we don't need with money we don't have to impress people we don't even like very much. Oh, that is the heart of you are, was where Abraham, and by the way, Abraham living in you are, he had a lot of E-R. He was wealthy. He had a lot of possessions. People could have looked around and wanted more than Abraham. But that wasn't Abraham. Abraham didn't look at his stuff and think more highly of himself. In fact, that is why God chose him to become the father of a great nation. And God said to Abraham, Abraham, I want you to leave where you got all this stuff. I want you to see, I want you to prove to me that your heart is right. I want you to leave all of this, and I want you to go to a place that I can't tell you yet where it is, but when you get there, I'll tell you you've arrived, and I want you to go to a place of promise that I provided for you. Though these two ers, er and ur, are not spelled the same, I believe God wants all of us to leave the land of Ur and to live in the reality of his promises and not in the neighborhood of our preferences. Have you identified your Ur in the world right now? Have you done that this week? Have you discovered where you have been thinking Ur too much? Have you found the source of that? And have you called it by name? I'm jealous. I'm prideful. I'm envious. I put too much bank on my job position. I put too much bank on my account balance. I put too much bank on my image. I don't want anybody to know I've got problems. Are you prepared to leave your behind? We receive messages in one way or another from different situations in our lives that give us a sense of inferiority. And those differences with other people become the yardsticks by which we measure ourselves and our own personal worth. Who or what have you been using as a yardstick, and you have not even noticed that until recently? I remember one pastor, probably I was in my late 20s when I heard this pastor say this in a sermon. He said, comparing ourselves with another person is like one pygmy backing up to another pygmy to see which one is taller. Seems rather futile, doesn't it? So is trying to find satisfaction or contentment in wanting more than somebody else. And last week we looked at a story out of the Old Testament in 1 Samuel chapter 16, and it's the story of how David, who was just a shepherd boy, was chosen to be king of Israel. Samuel, the prophet of God, had been sent to Jesse's family, and God told him one of Jesse's 8 sons is going to be the next king. And Samuel made the mistake. He first saw the firstborn, and man, he was tall, he was good-looking, he was well-built. And Samuel said, this is the next king. And God said, whoa, 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 back up. And God gave us a key principle right there when he said to Samuel, hey, Samuel, people look on outward appearances and make their evaluations of worth. God said to Samuel, that's not the way I work. I look at the heart. I look at what's on the inside. And that's the key difference between often the way you and I determine our own worth and what God has declared us to be worth. Last week we reflected at the end of it. This will be the end of our review on what was the key point. Does anybody remember the key point we reviewed at the end of last week's sermon? We repeated it together. There is no win in comparison. Can we say that all together? All right, 1, 2, 3. Good, good. You see, the reason there's no win in comparison is because there's never a finish line. There is no final place of satisfaction. You're always looking to the right and to the left to see who's got bigger than you. And when you find somebody with a bigger than you, that makes you think there's something wrong with you. And you're always looking for people with less than you. And when you find them, you begin to feel superior to them. And then your conscience is pricked because you think there must be something wrong with you because you feel better about being better than somebody who has less. So there's just no win in this. And what we didn't even touch on at all last week, some of the type A personalities in this issue. Okay, Andy did this in the study, and some of you might remember. All right, type A personalities, they're not content to live in the neighborhood of Ur. Where do they want to live? They want to live in Est. They want best. See, better is not good enough. Richer is not satisfying enough. They want to be the richest, the prettiest, the most successfulest. Here's the problem with that. We eventually get older. And the people who live in the neighborhood of Est, the neighborhood they don't want to live in, is oldest. Because when they get to old S, then what they discover is was better. Because there's younger, faster, stronger. And they realize Est is no longer attainable for them, and their self-appraisal, their self-worth that's been shaped by Est is now gone. Today, the key question at the outset is, who or what am I going to use as a reference point to tell me that I'm okay? Who or what is the reference point that you use to tell you that you're okay? And what's that reference point revealing to you about you? See, some use another person, a colleague, a coworker, an employer, a friend, a parent, a spouse. Some parents live through their children, a model, an actress. Some, and here's a kicker on that. The people that we often use that we think are all right and we use them for our personal evaluation, do you realize that most of them don't think they're all right and there's somebody else they're using for a yardstick? Some people use job. They use their position, their power, their salary, and I just heard this one on the news this week on the radio, perks. I heard that the current employment generation would rather have perks than a higher salary. Why? Because really nobody likes to talk a whole lot about exactly what they make, but they like to brag about their perks. So that means people like to be perkier than other people. I just came up with that in the 8 o'clock service. I didn't work on that one all week. That just kind of came. Some people use GPA. That's where they get their worth from. Or what college they graduated from. Some people every morning use the weight scale. Some use TV and magazines. We all use something to answer the nagging question, am I okay? And can I suggest to you, we shouldn't be looking to the right or to our left. That maybe what we ought to be doing is looking up, looking into the Scriptures, which will draw our gaze up. I realize there may be some of you who are here today and you don't have confidence in God. You don't believe the Scriptures. Could I challenge you? If you hear that question in your heart, am I okay? Read the Scriptures, whether you believe them or not. Investigate them. It wouldn't be the first time that you've read something that you don't believe. Forgive me, Jim. Forgive me, Ray. But how many of y'all read the paper? Do you believe everything you read in it? You don't, do you? But you read it. Okay? I'm not going to ask for a show of hands how many of you buy the National Enquirer. But I'm telling you, a lot of people do. Okay? A lot of people do, because they wouldn't still be printing the rag if they didn't. Do you believe it all? No. And the people who I know, my grandma McLean, she read it every week, man. And she was a school teacher. And she said, oh, Tim, I don't believe half the stuff in here, but it's fun to read. Could I encourage you? The Bible might be fun to read if it could answer some key questions for you. So read it anyway. But when are we, that was the reason for these. Now, when are we ready to accept the biblical perspective and God's explanation of our value and our worth? It's usually when we've looked into the mirror. Can you see yourself just fine there? Karen, I want to get that right there. All right. when I asked for volunteers to sit on the front row and stare into the mirror, Karen was the first one, right, right, right? When we look in the mirror and we've decided, I quit. Until the 8 o'clock service, I had never, ever really been this close to a mirror. That's scary. If you've been here very long, you've heard me say that when I get up in the mornings, Shelly will tell you this is pretty much true, until I've had my shower, all that's on in the bathroom is the fan, not the light. Whatever ambient light comes through the window or comes from the other room is all I use in the bathroom until I have showered, shaved, and combed my hair. Because I just simply can't stand reality that early in the morning. It isn't good. And I suggest to you that often we read the Bible without turning the light on. Because we often don't want reality in our life. And it is only when we come to the end of ourselves that we're finally ready to hear what God has to say about us. We've been hearing what our neighbors have had to say. We've been hearing what our own heart has been saying. It's the reason I wanted to hear. I just picked a handful, and I didn't even get through the whole stack, okay? Here are some of the responses. Jesus became real when I realized I was alone. Jesus became real when my marriage crumbled because of drug addiction and infidelity. I had two little girls, and I now had to figure out how to live. Jesus became real when I realized I wasn't in control of the circumstances of my life. Jesus became real 3 years ago when I had a colon infection and had half my colon removed. Jesus became real the month I lost my husband and my daughter. Jesus became real when I realized I couldn't fix my problems I was going through and I needed a higher power. And there's only one higher power that can fix it. Jesus became real when I finally gave up drugs and when my wife was baptized. Did that happen on the same day, I wonder? No. Okay, all right. I told you, no names. Jesus became real when I became pregnant with my first child. Jesus became real when I needed strength and I knew it wasn't in me to do it independent of God. Jesus became real when in 2006 I was broken and in jail and I had nowhere to turn. Jesus became real. Jesus became real when a pastor hit me broadside, broke my neck. God healed me and now I'm His forever. That is an evangelistic tool I have not used yet. Okay. I'm gonna put a sight on the hood of my car. All right, I think. Jesus became real when during the struggles with my spouse's addiction. Jesus became real when cancer came. Jesus became real in high school. Two Sunday school teachers who were on fire for Christ made Him alive and real to me. Jesus became real when I was sitting in jail again. Didn't learn the first time. Jesus became real when my parents passed away 3 weeks apart during my divorce. Jesus became real when I was in a car accident. Jesus became real when I saw what He did in my mother's life. Jesus became real when trouble and turmoil at home because of alcohol and anger and depression took over my world. Jesus became real when I was studying evolution in school and I realized there was no way I came from nothing and that I must have a better purpose. You see, as I've shared often, in 30 plus years of pastoring, I've never had somebody walk into my life and say, "Pastor, my life is perfect. Could you tell me about God?" It's not happened once. It's always the opposite. My life's a mess. I have nowhere to go. I'm not sure I even believe in God, but I've got nowhere else to go. You see, usually when we look in the mirror and we're at a place to give up, like you've heard here, but I wished I could tell you this morning that once you come to the end of yourself and find Jesus, that it's once and done. But what you're going to discover is once you've come to the end of yourself, you will probably discover that in order for this process of spiritual maturity and for this development of sanctification, that's a word I'll flesh out a little bit in a moment, in order to get our practice to match our position in God's relationship, that there'll be this ongoing discovery. There'll be this multiple times in your life where you'll have to come to the end of yourself, because in order for us to accomplish what John the Baptist said was necessary in his life, I must decrease so that Christ can increase, we usually come to the end of ourselves several times throughout our life. Because as we go deeper and deeper and deeper, we learn there are layers to our self-dependence. And those need to be peeled away. And God takes us deeper yet. For example, and forgive me for being personal, but it's better than picking on you, I think, today. I've been on this planet 60 years now. Six decades. I can point to at least six end-of-myself moments. The first end of myself moment was when I was 5 years old. That's when I was born again. I had limited knowledge. I had limited experience. All I knew that night was when I died, I wanted to go to heaven and I didn't want to go to hell. And at five, I couldn't do anything about either one of those. That was the end of myself. So I gave my life to Jesus. I came to the end of myself 5 years later when I was 10. The most significant thing that had happened in my life up to that moment happened right after I turned 10 years old. My grandfather McLean died of a heart attack at age 70. And I realized he died in January, and that summer I was with my parents and my grandmother, and we were sitting, don't ask me why I remember these people's names, but it's just stuck with me. We were sitting in the Smithies' house. It was split. The house was split. They lived on a corner. And at one end of the house, it was the corner grocery store. Neighborhood store, and the back part of the building was where they lived. And my parents and my grandmother were in the store part with the Smithies, and for some reason I was left in the living room sitting in a rocking chair. And at 10 years of age, I remember sitting there and tears just flowing down my face, because at that moment I realized God had called me to preach. And I'm saying, who in the world is going to believe a 10-year-old? I can't start preaching yet. I'm 10. And yet I knew it. And I said, okay, God, but you're going to have to tell me when. And that when was 5 years later. I was 15. And now I didn't want to preach. I wanted to party. Jesus said, now it's time to fish or cut bait. Came to the end of myself and publicly acknowledged that call. I came to the end of myself at age 25. I'd been married less than a year. I was on staff with Dad at the church in Fresno. And one of my dad's best friends. And one of my best friends. Best man at my wedding. Led a coup to split the church. Wouldn't speak to me for over a year. Had no idea why. I remember laying in bed at the second story apartment I was living in, 25 years of age, and laying there and saying, God, if this is what ministry is all about, I quit. I don't want anything to do with this. And God yelled through the window, good, what I've been waiting for! I mean, literally, it wasn't through the window, but it was in my head. He said, Tim, ministry is not done because of charming personality or a gift of gab or sterling good looks. He said, Tim, ministry is done by me. If you quit, then I'm in business. I came to the end of myself at 40. When Ted and Carrie passed away and John died of a brain tumor, same brain tumor that Ted had, was having family financial struggles. The merger was less than 2 years old. I came to the end of myself at 52. The death of a marriage of 28 years. When I looked to my right and I looked to my left and I realized failure, and I assumed my life as I knew it was over. And on a plane, God said, I'm not finished with you yet. Do you believe what you've been preaching all these years? If you do, no, I'm not finished. At each of these stages of life, God's love was taking me deeper into dependence on Him and less. It didn't happen all at 5 years of age. It didn't happen all at 15. It didn't happen all at 40. God wasn't even finished at 52 and 7, 8 weeks ago in a hospital room. It was another level. As I got to thinking about this week, I'm almost wishing, maybe Lord, just take me now. I don't want the next one. It's not until we get a distance from there that we appreciate the value of what God has done as we go through each of these stages in our life. You see, He becomes real to us at those moments. And when did He become real to you? Here's what we need to know about who you are. Here's what I need to know about who I am. I don't need to look to my right or to my left. I need to look into the book and look up. I need to know what God says about me. And let me highlight some things very, very quickly. Here's what God says about you when you have come to the end of yourself and you have become a Christian. If you're here today and you're not a Christian and you're struggling with who are you, listen to who you can be if you will come to the end of yourself and become a Christian. But what I'm about to tell you only is true when we do come to the end of ourselves and trust Christ. The very first thing that we are told, and it's told in many places, I'm just highlighting a few, is we now are a child of God. We are now the King's kids. We are prince and princes in the kingdom of God. Romans 8, 12 through 16 says, therefore we are debtors, not to this world or the flesh. For if we live to this world or the flesh, we will die. But if by the Spirit we mortify the flesh, we will live. For as many as are led by the Spirit, that's the key, led by the Spirit of God, then we are the children of God. For you have not received the spirit of bondage again to fear, but you have received the Spirit, listen to this word, you have received the Spirit of adoption. At our new birth, we are adopted into the family of God. And Paul says, because of this process, we now cry out, Abba, Father. The Spirit itself bears witness with our spirit. We are the children of God. And Abba, Father, it doesn't quite cut it in our 21st century speaking. Do you know what the current translation of Abba, Father sounds like? The best it's been described to me by people who know a whole lot more is this was Paul saying, Dear Daddy. I had friends as a kid growing up. Not many. Well, let me say that differently. I had some friends who referred to their dad always as father. Always sounded a little highfalutin to me. It always sounded a little cold. And according to my recollection, most of the times I went into their home, that relationship seemed to be very cold. That's my daddy. The boys took that to another level. That's now Pops. Hey. And at 60, he would let me climb in his lap and say, Oh, Daddy, I hurt. I need something. And that's what Paul wants us to understand about our Heavenly Father. He is not some distant, cold being somewhere out there in space. He says, come climb in my lap and say, Oh, Daddy. Why? Because we are his chosen children, adopted. How did that happen? Because of the second thing, I am forgiven. I am fully and completely forgiven of all that I have done, am doing, and ever will do. I'm forgiven. That was paid for on a cross 2,000 years ago. Colossians 1:13 says, the one who has delivered us from the power of darkness, he has moved us into the kingdom of God. And he's done this by his dear son, in whom we have redemption through his blood, even the forgiveness of sins. We've been saved by the generosity of God's grace on the basis of our smallest amount of faith in him, according to Ephesians 2:8. God forgives our sins, buries them in the sea of forgetfulness, and he puts up a sign, no more fishing. We've also been justified. Therefore, being justified by faith, what do we have? Peace with God through Jesus Christ. God does not justify us because we are worthy, because we are worthier than somebody else. He justifies us to make us worthy. Not worthier than anybody else, to make us as worthy as his son. And that is a gift. The doctrine of justification is the foundation that supports all of the other benefits that are now ours in Jesus Christ. Sanctification, 1 Corinthians 6:11. Such were some of you. Such were some of you what? Some of you were prostitutes, and some of you were promiscuous, and some of you were very sinful, but you are now washed, you are sanctified, you are justified in the name of Jesus Christ by the Spirit of our God. Sanctification is not something our Lord does in me. Sanctification is the Lord in me. It is learning to turn him loose in us. It is not me learning how to behave better. It is me letting Jesus behave every day in my life. Listen to what Oswald Chambers, the great devotional writer of the book My Utmost for His Highest, says. He says, sanctification means a life of discipline, such as 9 out of every 10 of us will have nothing to do with. The test of sanctification is not our talk about holiness. It is not our singing of pious hymns, but it's what we look like when nobody sees us or when we are with those who know us best. We are also new creatures in Christ Jesus. 2 Corinthians 5, if any person be in Christ, they're a new creature. The old has passed away. Everything has become new. Child of God, you talk about a facelift. We get a life lift. Doesn't it look so much better, Karen? It looks a lot better now. The Wheel of Fortune. I know you like that picture. Number 3, we are redeemed from the curse of the law. We've been redeemed from the hand of the enemy. We've been delivered from the powers of darkness. This is what Jesus Christ did for us. He removed the curse. The scripture says, cursed is the one who hangs on the tree, and that was Jesus, and he did it for us. We now, because of that, the fourth thing about us, we are now the righteousness of God. 2 Corinthians 5, for he or she who was made, For he, God, hath made him, Christ, to be sin for us, the one who knew no sin, so that you and I, who were sinners, become the righteousness of God. You see, one moment, I look here, ugly sinner. And I come to the end of myself. And I give my life to Jesus. And he gives me the strength to look again. Saint. Saint Timothy. You are my child. You ever stood in front of a mirror? Called yourself a saint? You should, if you're a child of God. Not of works, because it's not about your bragging. It's a gift of grace so that we can thank him. We are blessed with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places. Ephesians 1, blessed be the God and Father of Jesus Christ, who has blessed us, not with some, not with a few, but with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Why? Because I'm prettier? Because I'm wealthier? Because I'm handsomer? Because of Jesus Christ. Last, I'm not moved by what I see. 2 Corinthians 4:18, while we look not at the things which are seen, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporary. In other words, don't look to your left and to your right. Look into the Scriptures. Look up to God, because they are the same yesterday, today, and tomorrow. They change not. Here's the problem. I got 8 minutes left, and I'm on page 5, and I got 35 pages right here. Just kidding. We can do this. In focusing on these qualities of this Father-like love of God for us, I hope that you and I can capture how much we matter to God. So let me ask you this other question. Do you know why you're here today? And when I say here today, I don't mean just at New Hope. I mean, do you know why you're on planet Earth today? That one question, I believe, carries 3 related subsequent questions. Was I planned? Am I known by anybody? Am I wanted? I mean, are we a child of chance or a child of choice? Were any of you an oops baby? Your parents told you. You came 10 years after your brothers and your sisters, all right? I mean, they thought they were past it. They thought they were older than that, all right? And come to find out, they weren't. And so, you know, you were, you know, there's a way you can say that you're an oops baby, and you come up with an oops. I wasn't wanted. They just had to put up with me. I have met folks like that over the years. And I've met adults who weren't oops babies, but that's the way they were made to feel. Is our existence incidental, or was it intentional? Am I a mistake, and do I live on the margins of life, or was I made to order and given a special place? Am I known? Apart from the question of original intent, we may wonder, have people forgotten us? Is there any ultimate knowledge of our inner existence? And ultimately, we want to know, does anybody want me? Are we acceptable? Are we of ultimate value? Well, if we really call God our Father, these are the most formative questions that we get answers to. For God says, I planned you, I formed you, I know you, I want you. In fact, we're not going to turn there simply because of time, but I want to encourage you to go read on your own the 139th chapter of the Psalms. You want to take a guess who wrote it? It's not Jesus. I mean, yeah, he sort of did, but who? Yeah, when we talk about David last? Last Sunday? Wasn't he our example? All right, the one who was chosen not by physical appearance, but by the heart. He writes about that in the 139th Psalm. Let me highlight just a few of the verses. Oh Lord, you have searched me and you know me. You know where I sit and when I rise. You perceive my thoughts. You discern my going out and my lying down. You're familiar, Lord, with all of my ways. Before a word is on my tongue, you know it completely. You hem me in behind and before. You've laid your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful, too lofty for me to obtain. For you created my innermost being. You knit me together in my mother's womb. Praise you because I'm fearfully and wonderfully made. Some of us read that and say, God, you did the fearfully part, but you didn't do the wonderfully part with me. Here's a question I thought of reading that this week. Yes, Jesus did the knitting in the womb. But did he do the knitting that makes you the person you are today? Or since you left your mother's womb, have you been making all those decisions? Have you been calling all those shots? But Jesus said, I knew you before you ever stepped foot into this world. How precious to me, David said, are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. Were I to count them, they would outnumber the grains of the sand. And when I wake, I'm still with you. You see, in this chapter, as well as many other places in the Bible, the greatest quest of the soul is answered. Yes, I was planned. You were not an oops. You might have been to your parents, but not to God. He knew what they were up to. He was there. You were planned. Now, you were also known. You were known. God said, I knew you in your mother's womb. David recognized how intensely involved God remains in those first six verses of Psalm 139. David knew God was intimately at hand in his life, and it gave him assurance. When Jesus was about ready to send his disciples out to expand the kingdom of God, they were nervous and scared to do it, and Jesus tells them this. He said, are not five sparrows sold for 2 copper coins? And not a one of those cheap birds is forgotten before God. And the very hairs of your head are numbered. Do not fear, therefore, you are more valuable than my sparrows. And just so you bald-headed people don't get puffed up, see, now here's what bald-headed people think. God likes them best because they cause him less trouble. Okay, so he still counts the ones you're shaving, okay? God knew you, God planned you, and God wants you. It's the reason for the cross. God sent his son for what purpose? So that the whole world could come to know Jesus Christ. Peter says in 2 Peter 3:9, it is the will of God that not any should perish. Let's wrap this up. Here's the key points of today's study. First off, I want you to know you are meant to be here. You're meant to be here right now. On earth. In your study this coming week, here are some things you're going to discover. You're going to discover that my greatest potential, your greatest potential, is not found outside the will of God. If you want to stop living in and stop struggling for est, find the will of God, and you will discover God's best for your life. It's found in the will of our Father. It's there. That you and I will be all that we are supposed to be. Number two, I want to see me the way God sees me. Could you repeat that after me? I want to see me the way God sees me. Number three, listen to God speak into your heart this truth. You're fine because you're mine. You're fine because you're mine. We need to take our cue about who we are from the one who made us, from the one who loves us, and from the one who redeemed us. Here's the flip side to that. If we don't do that, here's the end result. Proverbs 14:30 says, A sound heart is a heart that knows we were planned, that knows we're not forgotten, and knows that we are wanted. A sound heart is life to the body. But envy, living in and est, is rottenness to the bone. You want to live in the land of You will end up more rottener than you could ever imagine. If you're here today, and maybe you showed up at the end of yourself, and you needed to hear how much God loves you. I hope you've heard enough about the Father's love to take that first step into decreasing self and to increasing Christ. And consider being born again. If you're here today and you're somewhere in that journey from born again to graduation, that's heaven, by the way. Maybe you're at another point of coming to the end of yourself. Let God take you deeper into dependence on Him. Would you pray with me? Behold, I stand at the door and knock. If any man hear my voice and open the door. All right. Let's pray. Our Father, you hear the heart of a man or a woman right now who came today maybe uncertain. But by your Spirit, they've heard enough today to say they don't want to remain uncertain. And right now, they're making the discovery that you love them and you want to save them and you want to come live within their life. Then, Father, listen to their prayer of humility. No matter how it's worded, I know you hear them. And give them the assurance that you love them and you will never leave them. Father, for those who are here and they're at various stages of their spiritual growth and maturity, but they may be at a low point because this is a learning moment. They may be at a low point because this is an end of a self moment. This is peeling away another layer of or est or self-dependence, taking us into a deeper dependence upon you. Thank you for hearing our prayers this day. In Jesus' name, we surrender our lives. Amen and amen. Have a good afternoon.